Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew in the 22nd chapter. The Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. They sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying to him, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with the truth and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." They brought him a denarius. Jesus said to them, "Whose head is this? Whose title?" And they answered, "The emperor's." Jesus said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." And when they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him, and they went away. The Gospel of the Lord. Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Many years ago, I received a passionate and somewhat confusing letter on the subject of giving to God. Well, more specifically, it was to do with minding our business about people giving to God. The family that I got this note from had received, along with every other family in the church earlier that year, an invitation to give an estimate of giving for the coming year. You've probably seen them. They look something like this. We send them out every year. They're a big part. They're a really, really big part of our planning. They're a really big part of our planning and our visioning for each year in terms of preparing for ministry and mission, in terms of understanding what we're capable of as a church, in terms of what we can anticipate being able to accomplish from our goals and our visions each coming year. I mean, there's various sources of revenue and income, but these are huge in terms of us setting a plan for the coming year. Anyway, this person, this passionate missive that I got, was to question the right that we had to ask people to tell their plans to give to God. What business was it of us? Why did we need to know what people were doing? What people do with theirs is up to them, right? That's what the letter concluded. And it's really none of our business. Now, for starters, if you get this and you're bothered by it, if you get this and you think, "I'm not going to give them anything," all you got to do is just put it somewhere, just file it. You don't have to come at us about it. That's the first thing. So part of it is the pushback was a little bit unnecessary, a little bit over the top. And it was a little bit silly, because of course it matters. Like I said, it's critical to our plans for what's to come. In addition, these moments are a reminder of us, to all of us, that we faithfully respond to what God has given. We faithfully respond to what God has given to us. It's a reminder to make it a priority. It's a reminder to make a plan, because absent plans in life, things aren't going to happen. We all know that. And it's a good reminder to reflect on who owns our lives. Who owns our comforts and our dreams and our futures and what all of that is anchored to? Is it anchored to this or not? And that brings us to the question at the heart of today's gospel. Because beneath this question about taxation that it starts out with, the heart of what Jesus is saying in his brilliant response is that our heart, our faith, is made known by how we spend what we're given. That means our money, it means our time, it means our energy, it means our words, our actions, our hearts. Jesus responds to their question by saying, whose image is on the coin? Render to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. So there's two parts. There's two parts to Jesus' response. First part, Jesus navigates around this trap that the religious authorities are setting for him with their question about taxation. And it is a trap. Now, I probably sounded a little bit snide and sarcastic as I was reading parts of the gospel, because there's nothing authentic. They are not genuine in their question of Jesus, and they're not genuine in their flattery that they come at him with. And we know that from the get-go, because it says at the outset that the Pharisees sent their disciples with the Herodians. Now the only two things that the Pharisees and the Herodians have in common is they both believe in God and they both want to shut down Jesus. And that's it. Pretty much everything else, they can't stand each other about. So for the two of them to be together, that's a big red flag right there. So Jesus navigates around this by his answer. Because they're looking for something. They're looking for Jesus to say what's popular. Because for Jesus to openly proclaim that people should not pay taxes to Caesar, the Jewish people would love that. Most of the people would love it. Most of the people would give him a big pat on the back. Most of the people would want to proclaim him their new king. But Jesus would also be signing his death warrant. Jesus would be signing his death warrant with the Roman authorities if he told the people, don't pay your taxes. And Jesus wouldn't just be signing his death warrant, because we know that Jesus came to suffer and die for us. But Jesus came to suffer and die for us to liberate us from sin and death. Not to liberate us from fiscal responsibilities, not to liberate us from the Roman authorities, necessarily. Jesus says, don't pay taxes at this point. Jesus becomes a political martyr. Jesus becomes a zealot. Jesus becomes an economic rabble-rouser, just like a lot of other economic rabble-rousers that came before him. And that is where things would end with his life. He would be thrown on a pile with all of the other forgotten martyrs that came before him. That's what they're setting him up for. Jesus' response essentially says, well, his image is on this treasure. If he wants to build this kind of treasure, let him have it. Let him have it. That's part one of the answer, which is enough to shut down all of the foolishness that's going on. But then Jesus continues and says, render to God what is God's. Caesar put his image on currency. God's image is woven on our DNA. God's image is on our fingerprints and on our dreams and our visions. God's image is beaming in every act of justice and compassion and trust that we've ever witnessed or participated in. It's poured out in the world around us. It's being generated 24/7 in creation. It's thick in the choices that we make to affirm that love wins and that all human life is precious and sacred. And it's clear as a picture in every act of forgiveness Every act of grace, every act of mercy, every time we comfort, every time we heal. That is what we are sharing. Give to God what is God's. What is God's? It's all God's. In this story, I'll accept the money, apparently. Though, if you take a quarter or a dollar out of your pocket right now, whose image is on the coin? Well, there's an old guy, and there's probably a building on the other side, or an eagle on the other side. But another image on the coin, along with E Pluribus Unum and United States of America, is what? In God we trust. So even there, it's God's. Many years ago, Rabbi Lawrence Kushner was writing about the sibling sort of relationship that he's experienced between Christianity and Judaism. How both being cradled and raised up out of the family and children of Abraham, and how they have both embodied so much of the biblical witness alongside one another. But in talking about the differences, the distinctions that he sees between the two faiths, he remarked that there isn't as hard of a distinction in Judaism between the material and the spiritual, because as he so beautifully puts it, for the Jewish people, the world is full of God. And we often do ourselves a disservice, I think, not only in forgetting that we're stewards of all that we're given, and not just owners of it, and that we, and all that we have, is to be instruments and reflections of God. But we also forget sometimes how all-encompassing God's imprint is on everything that we see, everything that we hear, everything that we touch and feel and share. Earlier this month, I was in a meeting with the confirmation students. We were going through the creation stories, talking about those, and we were talking about the origins of humanity and the origins of sin and how that's conveyed in the story of Adam and Eve. And this led, as it often does, usually, I mean, whether you're talking with children or talking with adults, after a few seconds of reflecting on Adam and Eve, you come to this realization that we all sort of share DNA on some level, on some relation that all of humanity is connected to one another. And for middle schoolers especially, that usually, the next thing that usually happens is a lot of conversation about the logistics of that. Like, so-and-so, they'd be cousins, that sort of thing. But one of the kids, I think it was Rachel, actually. I think it was Rachel opined that maybe if we thought about it that way more often, maybe if we thought about how we're all connected and how we're all related, maybe we wouldn't treat each other so badly. Wow. There we go. And that's the biggest sobering takeaway when we realize that all is God's. Those we love, those we don't. God's. Those who love us, those who don't love us. God's. Ukraine, Russia, Israel, Gaza. All God's. I was really appreciative this week when I read the faith statements from Brooke and Bailey, who affirmed their baptisms earlier this morning. Because 3 years of learning nights and some Wednesdays the students are really attentive and really sharp, and some Wednesdays they're just exhausted. And I know that. So, you know, 3 years of talking about things, and you're never sure until you get the faith statements, kind of what really sunk in, what they really latched onto from all of that time. For both of them, one of the things that stood out had to do with God not being bound by limitations. Brooke said, "I believe he is there for all of us, I believe that God is everywhere in the world. Bailey said, God loves every single one of us equally. God works in our world in many different ways and actions. May we remember that God is present in all and through all. Dark times, hardest times of our life, God is not absent. God is holding out a hand to us in the middle of it. Times of bitterness and pain, God is every offering of consolation. God is every bright distraction that for a minute takes our attention off of the pain onto something else. Everything we say and do, God and our understanding of God is being put out there. We are bearers of the image of God. As clear as coins are bearers of people like Washington and Jefferson and Hamilton, we are bearers of God to the ends of the earth, to the end of our life. May we go be that as faithfully as we can. God is with us. God is all around us. The world is full of God. Amen.